Morning and welcome to the 8th meeting in 2016 of the Finance Committee of the Scottish Parliament. Could I please remind everyone present to turn off any mobile phones, tablets or other electronic devices. First item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed?
Yes.
Members have indicated their agreement. Our second item of business is to consider the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Amendment Bill at Stage 2. We are joined for this item by the Deputy First Minister, who is accompanied by Robert Buchan and Willie Ferry and Greg Walker. I'd like to welcome them all to the meeting. So we now turn to formal Stage 2 proceedings on the bill. I'd like to call Amendment 1 in the name of the Deputy First Minister, grouped with Amendment 18. Deputy First Minister to move Amendment 1 and speak to both amendments in the group.
The committee gave careful consideration to a number of calls for reliefs from the supplement, whilst cautioning that a preponderance of reliefs could give rise to complexity and opportunities for tax avoidance. Having reflected on the written and oral evidence, the committee recommended in its Stage 1 report a relief for purchases of 6 or more dwellings. In my response to that report, I was pleased to accept the committee's recommendation, as I'm well aware that the assistance given to first-time buyers through the introduction of this supplement needs to be balanced with the need to protect investment in the private rented sector. I note the decision to introduce this relief has been welcomed by the property sector. Amendment 18 in this group delivers the relief recommended by the committee. Amendment 1 is consequential and inserts a reference to reliefs into the overview paragraph summarising the content of new Schedule 2A to reflect the fact that there will be provision about reliefs in the schedule if Amendment 18 is agreed. I move Amendment 1.
Thank you. The question is that... Oh, sorry, we do have someone who wants to speak. Gavin?
Glad you're here. I welcome these amendments. I think they reflect the committee view. I think clearly the government here has listened to the committee and probably privately to industry. And I think without them, there would have been a risk to the housing supply. And I simply want to put on the record that I welcome them.
Okay, thank you very much. Deputy First Minister, anything further to add?
Nothing to add.
Okay, thank you. The question is Amendment 1 be agreed to? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. Call Amendment 2 in the name of the Deputy First Minister, grouped with Amendments 4, 5, 9, 13, 15, 16, 21, 22 and 24. Deputy First Minister to move Amendment 2 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, this group is a collection of technical drafting amendments. The Bill team has been careful to ensure that the wording of the Bill is as clear and as consistent as possible so as to minimise the risk of doubts or disputes over interpretation. Amendments 2, 4, 5, 21 and 22 ensure that the Bill refers consistently to a dwelling being the subject matter of a transaction rather than the main subject matter. In some cases, there may be other property involved in addition to the dwelling. Amendments 13, 15, 16 and 24 are similar and ensure consistency in references to a dwelling being or being part of the subject matter of a transaction or of trust property. Again, other property in addition to the dwelling may be involved in some cases. Amendment 9 in this group also clarifies the operation of paragraph 43B of proposed Schedule 2A to the Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Scotland Act 2013. This provides that where a transaction is a mixed property transaction containing residential and non-residential elements, the supplement is chargeable to the proportion of the chargeable consideration attributable to the dwelling or dwellings. Amendment 9 has a particular anti-avoidance function, which is to ensure that any subordinate real rights relating to a dwelling that are acquired along with a dwelling are not to be artificially severed when working out how much of the consideration is attributable to acquisition of the dwelling. As I indicated to the committee in my Stage 1 evidence, the Scottish General Anti-Avoidance Rule is on hand to deter and counteract artificial tax avoidance schemes, but this should go hand in hand with legislation that is as clear and well ordered as possible. I move Amendment 2.
Okay, thank you. Anything further to add?
Nothing to add, Convener.
Okay, the question is Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 3 in the name of the Deputy First Minister, group with Amendments 6, 10, 11, 12 and 33. Deputy First Minister to move Amendments 3 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, Amendments 3 and 6 ensure that only transactions with consideration of £40,000 or more are relevant to proposed Schedule 2A. The Bill currently includes a £40,000 threshold in relation to the value of properties already owned, but these amendments clarify that this threshold is also separately relevant to the chargeable consideration paid for the purchase of a dwelling. There are detailed rules for determining chargeable consideration in existing Schedule 2. Amendments 10, 11 and 12 ensure that the £40,000 threshold for the consideration paid for the purchase of a property is included as one of the conditions for the purchase of a dwelling when there are joint buyers. Amendment 33 makes a consequential amendment to the order-making power in paragraph 9.3, reflecting that there are now three references to the £40,000 figure. We will separately debate the parliamentary procedure applicable to paragraph 9.3 orders in one of the later groups. I move Amendment 3.
Okay, thank you. Anything further to add?
Nothing, Convener.
The question is Amendment 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 43 in the name of Gavin Brown, grouped with Amendment 17. Gavin Brown to move Amendment 43 and speak to both amendments in the group. Gavin.
Convener, I'm grateful. Thank you. Amendment 43 is an attempt to deal with something that has become known as the accidental second homeowner. For somebody who has a simple main residence and decides to change their main residence, if they purchase a new one but haven't managed to sell by the time they purchase, they of course would be liable to pay the tax. A huge number of transactions quite simply don't settle on the same day for a huge number of reasons. Some of course fall through entirely in the first instance, which can lead to a delay of weeks or months, and some simply take longer to sell than was envisaged under difficult market conditions. So it's an attempt to avoid that from happening. I draw members' attention to the Chartered Institute of Taxation paper, who said in their written submission to this committee, the inclusion of reliefs and exemptions should follow the policy objectives. Now, clearly, the policy objectives as set out in the memorandum from the government is not to bring people in this category within the realms of this tax, particularly some of them who may be purchasing properties that would otherwise not be subject to LBTT whatsoever because they're under the threshold. All of a sudden, they may have to pay 3% on the entire purchase price. The Chartered Institute of Taxation then say, in addition, consideration should be given to the Adam Smith principles, an issue on which I know the Cabinet Secretary, the government, and indeed this committee have attempted to stick to pretty closely. In terms of ability to pay, the first of those principles, again, for a number of those people, suddenly finding thousands of pounds at short notice to cover the shortfall, even if they get it back. In most cases, I'm sure they would get it back. But having to get that money in the first instance, I think, may be challenging for someone isn't necessarily linked to ability to pay. Of course.
I'm grateful to Gavin Brown for taking an intervention on this. He's mentioned a significant number of transactions that would fall into this category. When we took evidence at stage one, we were unable to get any kind of hard data behind what was essentially anecdotal evidence. Does Gavin Brown have a number to put on this? If he's speaking about a significant number, does he have that data to hand, and is he able to put it on the record?
No. I mean, it's a perfectly fair point Mr. McDonald raises. I mean, anecdotally, I mean, I only did conveyancing for 6 months, convener, but it was pretty obvious to me that somewhere between 10 and 15% of transactions did not settle on the same day. Now, that is anecdotal. I have formally requested the data which Mr. McDonald quite fairly asks for. I was hoping to have some for stage two, but it looks like it will, well, it's not here for stage two, it looks like it will be stage three, and I think that's a perfect point to make. But if that is correct, if the anecdotal, from my experience, is correct, and it's 10-15%, given there were 99,000 transactions last year, you know, you're potentially up in 10,000 transactions, which would automatically, therefore, affect every single constituency within this country, potentially. But I accept that that's not an official figure, and I advise everyone to treat it with caution, but it would not surprise me in the slightest if when the figures come in, it's of that magnitude. Are you happy to give me to Mr. Mason?
Yeah. I mean, and just in a sense, from the other point of view, I thank him for giving way. If he wonders how this would work in practice, because at the moment it's fairly clear cut, people have to pay the LBTT. If somebody is going to have to chase 10,000 people, or maybe even more, 60 days after, are we just not inviting the opportunity for people to slip through a loophole and never pay?
I don't think we are. I mean, I think I probably take a more generous view of the taxpayer than the picture that Mr. Mason attempts to create. I mean, I think given the fact particularly that all of these transactions, by their very nature, will involve solicitors, or almost all of them, to complete the legals. There is a limited number of firms, obviously, who are using the system at all, but particularly the online system. I actually think keeping track of these, given that most of them would ultimately settle, people don't want to pretend to move house. They do actually want to move house. And I think actually when it... ultimately, I think it would be more straightforward to keep track of. And you avoid the bureaucracy of taking in £3,000 here, £10,000 here, £20,000 here into the pot and having to then pay it back a week later or a month later or 9 months later or 17 months later. Actually, I think the system that is proposed in the bill is slightly messier, or at least as messy and complex as what is being proposed here. In terms of the principles, I don't think it's linked to ability to pay. In terms of certainty, you can be certain that if you don't sell your house in time, you'll be paying it. But that adds, it's a bit arbitrary. It means you don't know whether you're definitely going to sell your house on the day or not. And therefore, there's an uncertainty, I think, in the tax system by bringing it in. The principle of convenience, well, it's pretty inconvenient to suddenly have to find the money if your house doesn't sell on time, and all the other stresses and strains that are added to that in terms of, in addition to trying to find some kind of bridging. And in terms of the bureaucracy it creates, I think it's greater than the bureaucracy that would admittedly be created with some form of exemption. I think there's a personal injustice here on those who have to pay it at a time of stress. I think there is a degree of bureaucracy. And if you have a chain of transactions all relying on each other to happen on the same day, if one of them falls through, if one of them can't find the £5,000 or the £10,000 that they suddenly need to pay at short notice, and they pull out, what impact does that have on the market as a whole and on that particular chain? And from a wider, longer-term market perspective, if we end up in a situation where you pretty much have to sell before you buy, then I think that would be a huge change to the way in which the market has operated in Scotland for decades, if not centuries. And that would just ultimately see a reduced number of transactions. And people would just be a lot more cautious before moving house. And so for all of those reasons, convener, that is why I think the committee reached the view that we did. Now, we didn't agree as a committee on the timing, so members may not agree with the 60 days that I put forward. But I've tried to make that reflect the average time taken to sell, so that if your transaction does fall through, in most cases, you ought to be able to get your sale through. And so for those reasons, I move amendment 43.
Thank you. Deputy First Minister, to speak to amendments 17 and 43.
Convener, the question of a grace period has been discussed by the committee and was one of the main topics of interest at the Stage 1 debate. Both the Law Society and Revenue Scotland have been contributing their technical expertise on this matter to assist the government in its consideration. Amendment 17 allows for the possibility that a person could claim exemption from the supplement in the initial LBTT return. This may be possible where the sale of the previous main residence is completed before the LBTT return for acquisition of the new main residence has to be submitted. Therefore, no supplement would need to be paid, and that creates a grace period as part of the transaction. I recognise this does not provide a solution for all instances where the purchase of a new dwelling takes place before the sale of an old one, because the purchaser will need to submit their tax return in order to register the title to the property. As I've explained at the Stage 1 debate, I will monitor the situation for the first 6 months and decide if a further relief is required for a grace period, because that would give us the opportunity to tabulate the data to make sure that we have an informed debate about the extent of the issue with which we are wrestling. There is order-making power in the bill to allow this to be done by secondary legislation. Amendment 43 in Mr Brown's name would amend the bill so that the supplement only applies if, at the end of the 60th day after the effective date of the transaction, the buyer owns more than one dwelling. It is not clear how this amendment is intended to work administratively, since the LBTT return must be submitted within 30 days of the effective date. Essentially, the 60-day grace period would apply to all cases, which would cause a potential conflict with the requirement of the legislation for a return to be submitted within 30 days. So it's unclear the interaction between those two, and that would apply to all cases. There would be no way of exempting that. On the 60th day, it is unlikely the buyer will still be a client of the solicitor who submitted the return or have any ongoing engagement in that respect. So there are compliance concerns that I would have about the obligation to ensure that the all issues were resolved satisfactorily. And what this, I think, opens up is the possibility of increased costs of compliance and the necessity of the need to pursue potential debt liabilities, which one of the founding approaches of Revenue Scotland has been to minimise debt approaches that are available. There is, of course, a facility that an individual who is experiences a situation where they inadvertently end up owning two properties, where they can claw back the supplement if the sale goes through within 18 months of purchase. And if there are concerns about the operation of the property market, that strikes me as being a more comprehensive protection for individuals than believing that these issues can be resolved within 60 days, as would be suggested by Amendment 43. I hope that the committee can take my assurance that Amendment 17 allows for a grace period in certain circumstances, that I will monitor the number of cases where the supplement is repaid shortly after being paid to establish whether a further grace period is required. And on that basis, I therefore ask Gavin Brown not to press Amendment 43 and invite the committee to support Amendment 17 in my name.
Okay, Gavin Brown to wind up and press or withdraw his amendment.
Convener, thank you. I mean, in terms of the technical points, there would need to be a change to the return from this amendment. But there's going to be a need to change the return anyway as a consequence of this bill, because we currently don't have a 3% surcharge on all second homes. So changes to the return itself, I'm sure, are not captured in the legislation specifically and can be dealt with by regulatory powers. So I don't see that as a huge objection, and certainly when the Chartered Institute of Taxation made their recommendation of actually a three-month period, which is longer than the one I'm having, they certainly didn't see that as an issue that couldn't be resolved. But sure, I'm happy to give way to the Deputy First Minister.
It's an issue that can be resolved. The question is whether it's desirable to resolve it. And you know, the issue which I think Parliament has to be mindful of is there is an obligation within the tax arrangements we've put in place to collect taxation liabilities timiously, and I think the issue that Parliament settled on about the LBTT legislation was that had to be completed within a 30-day period. Respecting that point of timious resolution of these issues, that would not be available if we were to accept Amendment 43.
Okay, I don't accept that's true. I mean, I think changes to the return could easily capture as they submit a return. There could easily be a box saying we are selling our main residence, we are purchasing only a main residence, we are not attempting to be a second homeowner, and therefore it is our intention to pay it within 60 days if we haven't sold. In terms of the GAR that we set up, which is pretty wide-ranging, to me there is no huge risk to people slipping through the net. I think the greater risk is to the property market and the injustice to individuals in terms of having to pay this up front. It might be administratively nice, and I'm quite sure Revenue Scotland would favour that approach, but it's certainly not, when he says he's government speaking to Law Society as well, certainly in my conversations over the past week with the Law Society, it certainly doesn't appear to be their view in terms of the evidence they gave, in terms of the draft amendment they submitted, and in terms of their view at the moment, that actually they favour. They certainly don't, in my view, favour the approach suggested by the government. So I don't think the 30 days is a hurdle that would block this amendment. In terms of the issue that they would no longer be a client of the solicitor, I mean, I'm not sure I accept this either. I mean, ultimately, if they have to pay the money up front and in the future claw it back, for many people, the issue of clawing it back would require the assistance of a solicitor. Some people, I'm sure, would deal directly with Revenue Scotland, but given that they're not, most people aren't attached to the online system, they may well use the services of a solicitor to claw it back. So they're going to be involved in those cases potentially anyway. So I'm not sure, again, that is a strong objection to the amendment. If the, and I'll talk slowly, convener, just for the reason, if I got an indication from the Deputy First Minister that he was not against the principle of what I'm suggesting here, in that he is genuinely open to exploring how we exclude these kind of transactions from the ambit of the tax, and if he is sincere in doing, and he is sincere, but if he sincerely wishes to explore that and attempt to agree one which captures all risks and make sure that we don't inadvertently set this up, then I would be prepared not to press. But my impression is that he doesn't accept that principle. He wants to monitor it for 6 months, and while initially this may have been an unforeseen consequence, actually I think it is now a foreseen consequence, and in the absence of a hint from him that he accepts my principle, then I would intend to press the amendment.
Okay. The question is, amendment 43 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. We'll have a division. All those in favour of amendment 43? All those against? The amendment is defeated. I call amendments 4, 5 and 6, all in the name of the Deputy First Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Deputy First Minister to move amendments 4 to 6 en bloc. Does any member object to a single question being put on amendments 4 to 6? No one objects. The question is, amendments 4 to 6 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call amendment 7 in the name of the Deputy First Minister, grouped with amendments 8, 14, 25 and 37. Deputy First Minister to move amendment 7 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, Amendment 8 in this group is the main one. It relates to paragraph 3 of Schedule 2A, which applies to purchases by non-individuals, for example, companies, but it also applies to purchases by individuals in certain circumstances, in particular when an individual purchases a dwelling in the course of a business. The amendment changes the definition of business in that paragraph so that an individual's business is only relevant to paragraph 3 if it has a sole or main activity of trading in or investing in property. Amendment 8 also ensures that the definition covers a business carried on by individuals through a partnership. Amendment 8, together with Amendment 7, also applies paragraph 3 to purchases by individuals acting as trustees, unless the beneficiaries of such trusts have a relevant interest in the property. Amendment 37 provides a definition of what constitutes a case where the beneficiary has a relevant interest, basically an interest similar to ownership. The definition inserted by Amendment 37 will apply to a number of references in the bill to such beneficiaries, and as a consequence, Amendments 14 and 25 take out two existing definitions that are no longer needed. I move Amendment 7.
Thank you. Anything further to add? Okay. The question is, Amendment 7 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendments 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17 and 18, all in the name of the Deputy First Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Deputy First Minister to move Amendments 8 to 18 en bloc. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 8 to 18? Okay, the question is, Amendments 8 to 18 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 19 in the name of the Deputy First Minister and a group of its own. Deputy First Minister to move and speak to Amendment 19.
This amendment ensures there is no double counting of properties that are treated as being owned by an individual and those treated as being purchased by a business. The amendment ensures that if the supplement is charged on the purchase of a dwelling because it is made by a business, for example, a sole trader property, investment business or partnership, that it is not included as being owned by the individual when that individual purchases a dwelling in their own right. Amendment 19 also ensures that properties purchased through such businesses elsewhere in the world are similarly not included as being owned by the individual. This reflects the principle of equivalence. I move Amendment 19.
Nothing further to add, I take it. The question is, Amendment 19 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 20 in the name of the Deputy First Minister, group with Amendments 23, 26, 27, 28, 29, 35 and 36. Deputy First Minister to move Amendment 20 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, the policy for this bill is that to determine if the supplement applies, it is necessary to count the number of dwellings owned by the buyer at the end of the effective date. In many cases, this will be a simple exercise, since the ownership in question will be a simple ownership in Scotland or elsewhere. However, what counts as ownership is not always straightforward. The key principle underpinning this group is the principle of equivalence. Amendment 20 clarifies how the rule about only counting dwellings worth £40,000 or more is intended to apply. The subtle change is that for counting owned properties, one no longer looks to the market value of the dwelling as such, but at the market value of the ownership interest. This takes account of the fact that ownership interests will include equivalent interests that are deemed to be ownership, as we shall see in other amendments in this group. This reflects, for example, that the market value of a 90-year lease will be less than the market value of full ownership. Amendment 20 also has an anti-avoidance function to clarify that the value of subordinate real rights attached to an ownership interest are not to be artificially severed so as to take the market value under £40,000. Amendment 23 ensures that where a dwelling is subject to a bare trust, the beneficiary is treated as the owner. This treats bare trusts in the same way as other similar trust arrangements, under which the beneficiary has a significant interest in a dwelling forming part of the trust property. Amendment 26 is a technical drafting amendment for clarity and consistency. Amendment 27 reflects the no double counting principle. It clarifies that trustees and executors are not treated as owning property in their care unless they are the owner for another reason, for example, they are a relevant beneficiary. This is the counterpart to paragraph 11, which treats the beneficiary as the owner. Amendment 28 is principally intended to cover leasehold interest in England. The nuance is that this is done by reference to the closest approximation in Scots law, the notion of long leases, which are leases over 20 years. Long residential leases have always been rare in Scots law, and following implementation of the Long Leases Scotland Act 2012, they are now very rare. Nonetheless, a handful of long residential leases still exist, so where they exist, they are counted as ownership. This better delivers the principle of equivalence, so that a 90-year residential lease in Scotland and 90-year leasehold in England, which will exist quite commonly, will be treated equivalently. Amendment 29 delivers equivalence between trust life rents, which are already dealt with under paragraph 11 of proposed Schedule 2A, and what are known as proper life rents in Scots law. Amendments 35 and 36 clarify definitions in paragraph 15 that relates to trusts. Members will have noted the complexities that can arise when less common forms of ownership are in issue. I will ask members to bear that in mind when we debate the further group of amendments concerning delegated powers. And I move Amendment 20.
Okay, thank you. Anything further to add, Wayne?
Nothing.
Okay, question is Amendment 20 be agreed to? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendments 21, 22, 23, 24, 25, 26, 27, 28 and 29, all in the name of the Deputy First Minister and all previously debated. I'd like to invite the Deputy First Minister to move Amendments 21 to 29 on block.
Moved on block, is there?
Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 21 to 29? No member objects. The question is Amendment 21 to 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 30 in the name of the Deputy First Minister, group with Amendments 31 and 32. Deputy First Minister to move Amendment 30 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Convener, the policy for the bill is that the supplement applies when the buyer owns two or more dwellings at the end of the effective date. Often all relevant dwellings will be in Scotland, however, all existing property holdings anywhere in the world are to be counted. An important principle within the bill is the principle of equivalence, that an interest in a dwelling situated outside Scotland should be counted as ownership if the interest is equivalent to ownership in relation to a dwelling situated in Scotland. Currently, the bill cross-references UK stamp duty land tax legislation for interest dwellings situated in the rest of the UK. Stakeholders have commented that this is not a particularly clear approach, and I accept that. The amendments in this group adopt a simpler approach which better delivers the principle of equivalence. The test for what counts as ownership for dwellings situated outside Scotland will be the same whether the dwellings are in the UK or outside of the UK. The test is whether they are equivalent to the Scottish ownership interests as set out in a bill. In assessing whether an interest in a dwelling outside Scotland is equivalent to an ownership interest, Account will also have to be taken of the deemed ownership rules in Schedule 2A for special cases, as discussed in the previous group. I move Amendment 30.
Nothing further to add then, Deputy First Minister? I'm winding up? No. The question is that Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendments 31, 32 and 33, all in the name of Deputy First Minister and all previously debated. I invite Deputy First Minister to move Amendments 31 to 33 en bloc.
Moved en bloc, thank you.
Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 31 to 33? No one objects. The question is that Amendments 31 to 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 34 in the name of the Deputy First Minister, group with Amendment 38. Deputy First Minister to move Amendment 34 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Convener, at the Stage 1 debate, members raised the particular challenges of legislating to an expedited timetable, particularly the risks, as they saw them, of unintended consequences. The Land and Buildings Transaction Tax Scotland Act 2013, which this bill will amend, contains a number of delegated powers to ensure that there is flexibility within LBTT legislation to react to changing circumstances. These powers allowed for the development, for example, of a targeted sub-sale development relief, which was enacted by order last year. When introducing this bill, I proposed a measured package of delegated powers for the supplement, which are contained in paragraph 14 of the proposed Schedule 2A. Having reflected on the Stage 1 evidence, I consider it appropriate, in the interest of flexibility and future-proofing, to propose additional delegated powers to amend certain aspects of proposed Schedule 2A. This is what Amendment 34 does. Partnerships and trust arrangements can be very complex and give rise to some of the most difficult aspects of LBTT policy and practice. There are existing regulation-making powers in the 2013 Act to amend the LBTT treatment of partnerships and trusts, but these do not extend to Schedule 2A for the supplement. Therefore, Amendment 34 would introduce equivalent power for Schedule 2A, which is consistent with the existing power. In a previous group, we discussed amendments to Part 6 of Schedule 2A to improve and clarify the rules on what counts as ownership. I consider that this is another aspect of Schedule 2A where there should be power to adjust the provisions by regulations in the months and years ahead. I have in mind the complexity of some ownership arrangements, particularly cross-border arrangements or arrangements to mask true ownership. Lastly, I propose power to amend the interpretive paragraph 15, which is consistent with the existing power in the 2013 Act allowing for the definition of dwelling to be adjusted in other schedules should that prove necessary in future. Amendment 38 ensures that the regulation making power inserted by Amendment 34 is subject to affirmative procedure, which I consider to be appropriate given that exercises of the power would affect taxpayers' position in terms of their liability to the supplement. I move Amendment 34.
Okay, thank you very much. The question is that Amendment 34 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendments 35, 36 and 37, all in the name of the Deputy First Minister and all previously debated. I invite the Deputy First Minister to move Amendments 35 to 37 en bloc.
I moved en bloc.
Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendments 35 to 37? There are no objections. The question, therefore, is that Amendments 35 to 37 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 38 in the name of the Deputy First Minister, already debated with Amendment 34. Deputy First Minister to formally move.
Move, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 38 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 39 in the name of the Deputy First Minister, grouped with Amendment 41. Deputy First Minister to move Amendment 39 and speak to both amendments in the group.
Convener, the bill includes an order-making power to vary the 40,000 threshold by order. As drafted, this order is subject to negative procedure. The Finance Committee endorsed the recommendation of the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee that the order-making power should be subject to the provisional affirmative procedure. I am persuaded by the arguments that the committees have presented, and therefore Amendment 39 is to apply provisional affirmative procedure to the delegated power to modify the £40,000 figure. Amendment 41 makes a consequential amendment to the Revenue Scotland and Tax Powers Act 2014. I move Amendment 39.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 39 agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 40 in the name of the Deputy First Minister and a group of its own. Deputy First Minister to move and speak to Amendment 40.
Convener, this amendment is technical in nature. Changes were required to the rules for multiple dwellings relief to ensure that the calculation for that relief still works given the introduction of the supplement. No changes have been made to the principles underpinning multiple dwellings relief. This amendment is required to ensure the calculation of multiple dwellings relief still works, given the introduction of the supplement may be payable on some but not all properties that are subject to a claim for multiple dwellings relief. Having decided to accept the committee's recommendation on the relief for the purchase of six or more dwellings in one transaction, a further change was required to the rules to ensure that the supplement is not included in the calculation of multiple dwellings relief for transactions in which the relief for the purchase of six or more dwellings is claimed. Amendment 40 delivers both a new method of calculation for all purchases to which the supplement applies and multiple dwellings relief is claimed, and also changed the calculation for cases where the relief of six or more dwellings are purchased. I move Amendment 40.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 41 in the name of the Deputy First Minister. Already debated with Amendment 39. Deputy First Minister to move formally.
It moves, Convener.
The question is that Amendment 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 42 in the name of the Deputy First Minister and a group of its own. Deputy First Minister to move and speak to Amendment 42.
Convener, it is settled policy that the Bill will only apply to transactions with an effective date on or after the 1st of April 2016. There have been calls for me to delay this date, but I have been clear with Parliament that the supplement should come into force as planned to protect first-time buyers from the impacts of higher rates of stamp duty land tax in the rest of the United Kingdom. There is, however, a second limb to the transitional policy, which is currently pegged to 16th December 2015, the date on which I made my 2016-17 budget statement announcing the LBTT supplement. This limb requires missives to have been concluded on or after that date. It has been put to the Scottish Government that some purchases that were agreed in principle before the time of my announcement would not have progressed to conclusion of missives until a short while later, and so would be caught. I have sympathy with those cases. I therefore propose changing the conclusion of missives cut-off date to 28th of January 2016, which is the date on which the Bill and accompanying documents were published. The transitional policy will therefore be that the Bill will apply in relation to a chargeable transaction where missives were concluded on or after the 28th of January 2016, and the effective date of the transaction is on or after the 1st of April 2016. This will deliver fairness for taxpayers while not being so generous that undue opportunities for forestalling become available. I move Amendment 42.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 42 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. The question is that Section 3 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Sections 4 to 6 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are. The question is that the long title be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And that ends Stage 2 consideration of the Bill. The Bill will now be reprinted as amended and will be available in print tomorrow morning. Parliament has already agreed that Stage 3 proceedings will take place next Tuesday, the 8th of March, and that the deadline for lodging Stage 3 amendments will be noon this Friday, 4th of March. I'd like to now suspend the meeting to allow a changeover of officials. We'll be back in just a couple of minutes. So our next item is to take evidence from the Deputy First Minister on Scotland's fiscal framework. Mr Swinney is joined for this item by Sean Neill and Alison Byrne of the Scottish Government. We'll take evidence from the Chief Secretary to the Treasury on the same subject tomorrow before submitting our views on the agreement between the two governments to the Devolution Further Powers Committee later this week. Members have received copies of the agreement, and given the fact that we had a statement from Mr Swinney last week, we will go straight to questions. And of course, those questions will begin with questions from myself. I'm pleased to say, in terms of the document, that a number of these questions are actually answered by the document itself. I do have some 16 questions, but I am aware that the First Minister has to be away by 11 o'clock and that colleagues also wish to come in, so I shall limit myself to just a few. Listen, it'll be 17 if you don't watch it. Okay. So, let's see. First one I was going to ask, Gavin asked a meeting with yourself, Deputy First Minister, yesterday, so I don't want to steal his thunder on that one. So let's go on to the next one. Paragraph 23, the fiscal framework does not include or assume the method for adjusting the block grant beyond the transitional period. The two governments will jointly agree that method as part of the review, and the method adopted will deliver results consistent with the Smith Commission's recommendations, including the principles of no detriment, taxpayer fairness and economic responsibility. You're probably be aware that Professor Bell made some comment about this in the media this morning. I'm just wondering, what he's basically suggesting is that this kicks the issue into the long grass. So what would your comment be on, in terms of that?
What the agreement does is it essentially delivers the outcome that the Scottish Government sought in terms of the block grant adjustment mechanism. It delivers the outcome that would be generated by per capita index deduction, which we believe is the most effective way of delivering the principles set out by the Smith Commission and fulfilling the commitments that were made in that respect. The review mechanisms are consistent with the Smith Commission's proposition that such measures should be reviewed but not requiring persistent intervention, which is the point made essentially in paragraph 20 of the agreement. And the details of paragraph 23 essentially ensure that the Scottish Government has as much control over the process of the review as we have had over the settlement of the issues that have been at stake in the formulation of the agreement at this stage in the light of the establishment of the fiscal framework. I don't agree that the issue is in the long grass, because the issue had to be resolved for the application of the block grant adjustment, and that will be the application that will now take its course. So the implications of this agreement are not to delay anything. This agreement provides for a block grant adjustment mechanism that will be necessary and required to implement the agreement, and to do so on the 1st of April 2017.
Yes, I mean, do you now feel, actually, after months of negotiation, that the positions between both governments have changed somewhat? Are you of a view that the relationship is much more of a bilateral relationship than it perhaps was previously?
The key issue that, or the key characteristic of these discussions, and this is again reflected in paragraph 23, Convener, is that the Scottish Government has been in a position whereby we have been able to agree with the Treasury, the and the United Kingdom Government, the details of the fiscal framework. That has been something that has required our consent. The financial arrangements under which we normally operate don't tend to operate in that fashion. I have previously explained to the committee my frustration over the details of the approach taken in the statement of funding policy, for example, which controls the arrangements, or formally controlled the arrangements around the financial management of the Scottish Government, but it was agreed between the United Kingdom Government and the Secretary of State for Scotland. I was never a signatory to that document, but I had to operate within its constraints. I have clearly been a signatory to this agreement, and that's a much greater advance on our normal position.
So it puts things on a much sounder footing as we go forward. Now, paragraph 20 of the agreement says that revenues from courts and tribunals in Scotland will be retained by the Scottish Government from April 2017. How much on an annualised basis would that amount to?
I don't have a figure to hand, Convener, but I'll certainly write to the committee about that.
Okay, thank you. And the following paragraph says that the implementation dates for welfare will be agreed by the Joint Ministerial Working Group on Welfare, and the Joint Exchequer Committee will oversee the transfers of fundings. When is that likely to be? Have you got any further information on when that's likely to be?
I think this is an area where we will want to make as swift progress as we possibly can do. But as I think have to forgive me, Convener, I appeared in front of two committees on this subject last week, so I may have said this to the other committee, or I may have said it to the Finance Committee. So if I have said it to the Finance Committee,
on it last week.
But essentially, we will have to put in place the necessary arrangements to ensure the continuity of provision at the very minimum for individuals who will be recipients of welfare payments, and that will require careful preparation to ensure that all of the necessary arrangements are in place to enable that to happen. Now, the Scottish Government, and I have no reason to believe the United Kingdom Government will take any different view, will want to proceed with that in as timorous a fashion as we possibly can do, but we have to acknowledge there will be a range of practical issues that have to be wrestled with to undertake that particular change.
Thank you for that. Now, in terms of administration and implementation costs, there are 10 paragraphs on that. There's a number of questions I was going to ask that, but it might be easier just to ask a kind of overall question. First of all, paragraph 30 says, in line with the Smith Commission recommendations, the UK Government will transfer funding to support a share of the associated implementation running costs for the functions being devolved. And last week you were asked questions basically about the £200 million to support the implementation of new powers, the baseline transfer of £66 million to cover ongoing administration costs, etc. And then there was information about additional administration and programme costs associated with the exercise of powers in paragraphs 44 to 45 of the Smith Commission Heads of Agreement. I'm just wondering, though, if you could give us a wee bit more information on what your broadest, or in fact, your most accurate, I should say, Ron, broadest, estimates of the costs of administration implementation will be, and what the overall likely support from the UK Government is going to be relative to that cost. Because, for example, in paragraph 35, it says that the Scottish Government will reimburse the UK Government for net additional costs wholly and necessarily incurred as a result of the implementation and administration of the income tax powers. So what I'm basically looking for here is, once the dust settles, what will the cost of implementation be, and what will be the kind of funding that the Scottish Government actually has to deliver that, and whether or not there will be any kind of gap that we have to fund from existing resources?
The funds that will be available are clear in the agreement. There will be a transfer of a one-off transfer of £200 million to support the implementation of the powers that are involved in the agreement, and there will be a transfer of £66 million on an annual basis that will be uprated in line with the Barnett formula to support that operation. So it is absolutely clear what funding will be available as a transfer from the United Kingdom Government to the Scottish Government. What it actually costs the Scottish Government is partly directly under our control, and because I will be, although I have estimate, I'll come on to give the detail about the estimates that have been made of these factors within the Scottish Government, but we will be the determinants of the costs of the implementation of these provisions by the decisions that we take, and obviously I will be trying to minimise the impact of that cost on the public purse. There will be other costs, which, for example, the devolution of the Scottish rate of income tax, which becomes effective on the 1st of April. Under the existing funding arrangements, the Scottish Government has paid for the implementation costs of that change, and that is really a product of the statement of funding policy and the arrangements that have operated habitually on this question. I envisage there may well be some further but pretty minor costs in relation to income tax, given that the overwhelming majority of the income tax devolution has essentially been affected by the Scottish rate of income tax being applied. There will be other specific costs to which you've referred in this section, convener, which, for example, on the costs around VAT assignment, we have agreed to share equally all costs wholly and necessarily incurred as a result of the implementation and the administration of VAT assignment. So there are specific provisions that will be in place in that respect. When it comes to the estimates that we've made, we made estimates which were based on DWP data and also on further research that the Scottish Government undertook that suggested there was a cost range between £400 and £600 million in relation to the implementation of the welfare provisions. Now, the UK Government, the Smith Commission agreement said the UK Government should pay a share of those costs, and the share that has been agreed is £200 million, which I think is a fair account on these issues. But I come back to my point, convener, that I made a moment ago. Whilst we may have made those estimates that will be the cost, I will be undertaking the exercise of these responsibilities with the objective of minimising the cost to the public purse.
I mean, I know Lord Forsyth and others are unhappy even at the £200 million and the £66 million a year, but I'm just, I mean, that's clearly set out in the document. I'm just looking to see what kind of margins there are, what kind of additional costs the Scottish Government is likely to have. Now, I know you're trying to minimise these costs, but when do you think we'll have some hard and fast figures on what the Scottish Government's contribution to these will be?
I think there'll be a number of stages at which that becomes apparent. In the provisions here, for example, in paragraph 33, there is a different cost arrangement put in place where it is repeated that the Smith Commission heads of agreement indicated the Scottish Government would meet the costs of varying the elements of universal credit. So, I can't possibly unpick what was the Smith Agreement proposition in this respect. I have to respect that. And obviously, we will calculate those. We'll be acting to minimise those costs as we proceed through the devolution of these responsibilities. Equally, to go back to the paragraph 37, the equal share of costs on the assignation of VAT, these will become apparent as we go through the process of joint working with the United Kingdom government on this work. But I don't, for example, expect I would be very surprised if the costs in relation to the assignation of VAT reached between the two governments anything in seven figures, for example. So I'd be very surprised if it got to a seven figure sum. So these are, there will be varying levels, but obviously I think on an ongoing basis it will be important that the government updates Parliament on the negotiation of these costs. I think if I go back to the Scottish rate of income tax, I think the early estimates of the cost of the devolution of the Scottish rate of income tax were of the order of £45 million, if my memory serves me right, but we are now significantly less than that as the programme has been taken forward. And obviously, ministers will be anxious to minimise the costs involved to the public purse.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Now, no detriment, we know, but there's been much discussion about that, and you've got 10 paragraphs in here about no detriment due to policy spillover effects. And as we know, the Smith Commission stated there's been no detriment as a result of UK government or Scottish government policy decisions post-devolution. Now, in paragraph 52, it says any decision to transfer relating to a spillover effect must be jointly agreed by both governments. Without a joint agreement, no transfer or decision will be made. But then, prior to that, in paragraph 47, it talks about the main categories of these can be divided into direct effects, which are financial effects directly and mechanically existing as a result of the policy change, and then behavioural effects resulting from people changing behaviour following a policy change. Do you have any concrete examples, for example, of what a direct effect it could be in terms of this particular agreement?
Well, I'm not sure I've got I can only speculate on what direct effects might be like, but in welfare, you know, where, for example, the Scottish Government was to increase eligibility for certain devolved benefits in Scotland, which automatically passport the recipient onto certain reserve benefits, that would be a traceable direct benefit, a direct effect of what the actions the Scottish Government had taken. So we had taken a decision to extend eligibility around a passported benefit, which was not the case in the rest of the United Kingdom, giving rise to essentially increased cost for the DWP. That would be very clearly identifiable. So I think that's one example of how this could be how this could crystallise. But the approach has to be very clearly demonstrated and evidenced to the satisfaction of both governments.
Okay, thank you for that. Now, just one other section before I open up to colleagues, and it's on capital borrowing. Paragraph 54 says due consideration was given to the merits of a prudential borrowing regime in line with the Smith Commission's recommendation. Of course, that was also recommendation of the Finance Committee. I'm just wondering why that was rejected.
My sense of it would be, convener, that and this is where there's, you know, there has to be give and take in a negotiation. The UK government has taken forward an approach which they're perfectly entitled to take forward within their reserved responsibilities to create a fiscal framework for the United Kingdom that involves by 2019-20 no borrowing whatsoever. And the Chief Secretary and the Treasury are anxious. Well, they make the fair point to me that if there is to be facilities for Scotland to borrow, consistent with the Smith Commission and the fiscal framework, then there has to be some compatibility between that borrowing and the fiscal framework of the United Kingdom. And of course, the Smith Commission report made it clear that we had to operate within the fiscal framework of the United Kingdom. That was, after all, the conclusion of the referendum in September 2014. So therefore, what I had to accept was, in exchange for securing additional borrowing powers, which I have been able, and borrowing capacity, which I've been able to secure, I have managed to do that within an environment which enables the UK government to continue to protect the fiscal framework they believe to be important to protect in relation to the management of the macroeconomic issues of the United Kingdom. So in a sense, a prudential borrowing would have not given the UK government the context within which they could have operated and fulfilled their commitments in relation to their own fiscal framework, because essentially that would have been down to decision-making undertaken by the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament, looking at what we could judiciously and prudentially borrow to support long-term investment. And the UK government, I think, fairly made the point that they needed to have some greater framework which assured them of the compatibility of the borrowing arrangements with the wider UK fiscal framework.
Still seems anomalous to me that councils in Scotland can have providential borrowing, but not the Scottish Government. But just one last point on this borrowing, which is in terms of interest rates. Paragraph 59 says the Scottish Government may borrow through the UK Government from the National Loans Fund by way of a commercial loan. I'm just wondering if there's any special rate the Scottish Government's been able to negotiate in terms of borrowing, or will be able to negotiate.
Obviously, when we borrow, we'll be we will be involved in negotiation on what is the bluntly what is the cheapest borrowing that's available, and that's what we will pursue on every occasion.
But yeah, because previously there was a concern that you may have to pay above odds. The UK government was looking that perhaps you would have to pay 1 or even 2% above commercial rates. Is that not going to be the case?
I couldn't. I wouldn't see what the justification would be for that.
Okay, thank you. I'll open up now to colleagues around the table. First to ask question will be Leslie, followed by the Deputy Convener.
Thank you, Convener. Can I ask Deputy First Minister about paragraph 66? When we had discussed this, and it was really useful to have the text, can I just ask, because I think it's just about the wording of the paragraph. I think it's maybe not as clear. So when we say Scotland-specific economic shocks triggered when onshore Scottish GDP growth, is that meaning GDP growth there?
Yes.
So that's... I just thinking, because if we're going to be held to this, that we would want that sort of clarity. So it's GDP growth is below 1% in absolute terms. Does that mean in real terms?
No.
So what do you mean in absolute term? What do you mean? Do you mean like
just if it grows, like if it's like. One, you know, there's a growth calculation. That's, you know, if onshore GDP growth is 1% below in absolute, in just in like 1%.
So when you look at the figures, when you look at the figures, I think it would be better for our interest if it was in real terms. I'm not. It's not a criticism. I'm just thinking. No. Because I've had Spice look at it as well. And actually, because if there is an economic shock, right, as determined by this, if you look at the and also it goes on about 1% on a rolling quarter basis. What do you mean by that? Is that? Do you mean? Like an annualised GDP growth on a quarterly basis.
I mean four quarters, rolling. So 1, 2, 3, 4.
So you mean like a moving average then?
No, I mean one quarter one, quarter two, quarter three, quarter four. That's
okay.
What I mean
I'm a wee bit concerned about that, because if you look at the figures, if you look at the data, we wouldn't. Over the last, since the figures that we've had since 1999, then the criteria would never be met.
Well, they might not be met because
no. It was during the recession, right? So,
let's just take stock here. Take stock here. What I'd like to reassure Leslie Brennan about is that. Macroeconomic, United Kingdom economic shocks, the management and dealing with those issues is a matter for the United Kingdom government because these issues are reserved. So in the economic downturn of 2008, 2009, 2010, whatever time period you want to take it over, that is entirely the responsibility of the United Kingdom because there is a United Kingdom economic shock. Paragraph 66 refers only to a set of circumstances where Scottish economic performance is, where there is no United Kingdom economic shock, and Scottish economic performance is poor in comparison, and paragraph 66 defines what a Scottish-only economic shock would be like.
Okay, can I? Because I asked people at Spice, the economists at Spice, to have a look at this as well. Okay, and one of the Spice researchers has said, if it is, you know, like the quarter one, the change from quarter one to quarter two, right? So if you're looking at additionally quarterly growth in quarterly GDP is unlikely to be one above 1%. That would give an annual GDP growth of 4.1% or more. So he's saying that annualised GDP growth on a quarterly basis.
I think that's a misreading of what's here, because I think, you know, when onshore Scottish GDP is below 1% in absolute terms on a rolling four-quarter basis, so that's over a four-quarter period. So if Scottish GDP, onshore GDP over a four-quarter basis, is 1% below in absolute terms and 1% below UK GDP growth over the same period, we have a Scottish-only economic shock.
I'm honestly not trying to be critical. I just want to make sure that if we're putting the fiscal rule in, that actually the threshold is not... It's not too high that we'll never actually, if there was a downturn, a Scottish-only downturn, that actually it's almost unrealistic to actually meet that threshold. So the other thing, because it says in here about the outturn, because obviously the lag in the data. So to be able to identify an economic shock based on the outturn data, it's 18 months after the economic shock starts.
It will be about that, yes.
So
potentially. Maybe not 18, it might be 15 months. But it'll be, you know, but then... You know, an economic shock, you know, it happens over a period of time. So we have to be, you know, that's what that is triggering is resource borrowing to deal with circumstances.
But if we,
if I feel an economic shock is coming and happening, I'll be changing policy and I'll be doing things differently. And I'll be, and you know, let me give an example. If I see an economic, you know, we don't just sit around for 15 months thinking, oh, where is this economic shock coming from? Whenever we see that economic data turning, we start acting. If we go back to the summer of 2008, I started in the summer of 2008 to revise my capital investment programme because I could see a problem in the housing market as we headed towards the financial crash of the autumn of 2008. The Cabinet took decisions to change our investment programme, and I started shifting resources into capital expenditure to shore up capital investment. So right away I started to act. What this is about then giving me the financial flexibility to deal with the consequences of that if it was a Scotland-only economic shock. Now, to go back to the 2008 example, what I had to do then was I had to go to the Treasury and say, could you perhaps give me a bit of flexibility over my capital borrowing, my capital DEL budget over a series of years to allow me to inflate capital expenditure in the short term? And to the credit of Her Majesty's Treasury, they agreed to that at that time. What this would do is it would allow me to take some decisions in the short term to change spending priorities and different interventions. And then this would give me the resource borrowing capability to deal with that economic shock.
Yeah.
If it was Scotland only.
If you're confident, and comfortable with that, the Fraser Island... Allender Institute, his article says, it's titled, How Wrong Were We? And it shows that models performed poorly in predicting turning points. So when we're forecasting, so there's a couple of things. So we're forecasting, if assuming we're going to be forecasting quarterly GDP growth. That.
Yep.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And forecasting GDP growth is obviously going to be more challenging than forecasting annual GDP growth. That's what the experts suggest.
Well, actually, the forecast issues about GDP will be designed by the Scottish Fiscal Commission, as I've indicated. I've agreed to those changes as part of the fiscal framework. The Fiscal Commission will give us. I actually don't know if the Fiscal Commission will give us a quarter by quarter performance. They'll have to give us a quarter by quarter performance to enable us to arrive at an annualised estimate. So, they'll have to. Yeah.
But okay. Then, so So if you're comfortable with that, that was my concern when I read paragraph 66 about the language, about actually there could be. I just thought I could be do with a bit of firming up on the language, just to make sure that there was clarity there. If the government's been held to account to this, and actually that's the threshold, if there was an economic shock in Scotland specific, and then income or the other taxes the receipts that you were expecting to come in have not been met, that you would want to draw down additional resource. That was my concern, that actually to make sure that this threshold is not unrealistic.
I think, you know, we've gone through a lot of analysis and discussion around these circumstances, because the United Kingdom government, and you can ask the Chief Secretary about this when you see him tomorrow, they're very clear that it's their responsibility to deal with a UK economic shock. So,
but I'm talking about a Scotland specific one.
I'm crystal clear about that. But so they're very clear about their responsibility for a UK economic shock. And what this does is acknowledge that there would be certain implications for Scotland if there was a Scotland-only economic shock. And I think, having looked at the analysis, this is a reasonable trigger point for this to be undertaken.
Okay. Can I ask about paragraph 19, just quickly? Can you just talk me through about you see here, during the transitional period up to 2021-22, however, there'll be an annual reconciliation process to achieve the indexed per capita outcome. Can you just talk me through that?
Well, essentially, the comparability model will be run, and it will give a certain outcome, and the per capita index deduction model will be run, and it will give a certain outcome. And if there is a difference between the two, they will be reconciled to the per capita index deduction outcome.
So we'll get
per capita index deduction as the outcome.
Okay, yes. Thank you. Okay, that's everything.
Thank you. And it's joined to follow by Gavin.
Thanks, convener. Cabinet Secretary, last week I asked you about VAT, and I think we kind of postponed the discussion a bit until we actually all saw the document. So if I could go back to VAT, could you just give us again the thoughts as to why we're using the consumption method, which I understand means it's all based on the final consumer? And the downside to that, I had thought, would be that if we built a new factory and there was value added, we wouldn't gain any of the VAT in that. I'm just wondering if it's a kind of admin question more than anything else, but I'd be interested to your comments on that.
I'm not sure we'll be able to go much further into the detail of all of this beyond the fact that we've agreed in principle a consumption-based approach. The methodology for all of this literally has to be composed to enable this to be undertaken, and that methodology will be taken forward, as the agreement says, as a joint initiative between the Scottish and United Kingdom governments for implementation in 2019-20. The work that will have to be undertaken will look at a range of questions around household expenditure, around VAT on business expenditure, VAT on government expenditure and housing expenditure. And we'll be looking at a number of different techniques which enable us to undertake that activity. So we'll be there will be a comprehensive exercise having to be done to identify and to resolve many of the detailed points that will be implicit in this methodology, and obviously that will be available for the committee to scrutinise as it is formulated.
Okay, I suppose my key point is, you know, if there's some kind of process that goes through, say, 10 steps, then the way VAT works, as I understand it, is that there's a bit of VAT added at each of the 10 steps. But my assumption is that to divide all of that in a Scottish basis would just be incredibly complex, and you've already answered the convener saying that you're hoping to keep the admin costs down on that. So would that be one of the reasons why we've gone for the consumer and we're just really looking at the final step?
Yes, and ultimately I think we've got to remember that this is an assignation process. This is not an actual revenue generation process. So you've got, you know, an assessment being undertaken of the total amount of VAT that is being generated within Scotland on this methodology. There will then be 50% of that will be assigned to the Scottish budget, and the block grant adjustment will be calculated accordingly. So it's all within that overall block grant assessment that this exercise will be undertaken, which gives a flavour of the degree of risk that we carry around that.
Yes. So is it 50% or is it 10p? Because if they vary VAT to 19 or 21%, how does that affect us?
It's 50% of the rates.
Right, so then we'd get 9.5 of 19 or 10.5 of 21.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, thank you. On no detriment, I think we've kind of agreed the first step, but it was more the second stage of any kind of spillover. And the agreement, it talks about it in paragraphs 44 onwards. And I was interested in paragraph 55 in particular, which talks about behavioural effects that involve a material and demonstrable welfare cost or saving. It talks about exceptional circumstances and behavioural effects that are demonstrated to be material, and both governments agree it's appropriate to make an adjustment. Can you give any examples of where that might happen?
It really would follow from any policy decisions that would be taken by individual governments, and I'm not really in a position to speculate about all of this, other than to say that the wording in the agreement sets a very high bar as to when these issues would come into consideration. Mm-hmm. So this would not be a routine issue. This would be, you know, the language is material, detrimental, exceptional. Yeah. This is not an everyday occurrence. This is a really, and obviously, both governments have got to agree these provisions and these factors. So this is not something that is going to be happening on a habitual basis.
Okay, so because the worry before was that almost anything anybody did in both sides of the border would have some kind of knock-on effect. Yeah. So basically, we're kind of sweeping out all of these minor things.
I think what I'm clear about is that the language of the agreement sets a very high bar before any of these provisions would be invoked.
Right. Thank you. On the block grant adjustment, I suppose I'm seeking a bit of clarification on some of the different taxes. I mean, the suggestion in the agreement, as I'm reading it, is that it's the year before a change is made, either income tax or LBTT or whatever, and the adjustment would be based on that. Now, for LBTT, for starters, we'd previously talked about maybe a five-year rolling average or something along these lines, I think, depending whether we'd look back or look forward. Is that now replaced by the idea that we're just looking at 1 year for the block grant adjustment?
For the baseline adjustment, it is based on a year zero calculation of what was the revenue generated in that year before devolution, and that then drives the baseline adjustment.
Okay. And for income tax, I mean, the point's been made that for, say, the year 2017-18, we will not know the receipts until March 19. So will the adjustment be made on the forecast of the receipts? And if so, how does the SFC and the OBR work on that if they have got different forecasts?
There will be, well, the forecast that will matter under the new arrangements I intend to put in place will be the forecast generated by the SFC, subject to a provision that I want to reserve the right to use an alternative forecast if I don't have confidence in the SFC forecast. But that's an issue we'll come on to discuss in the SFC bill at stage three, if Parliament is agreeable to that. So the SFC is forecast by the SFC, but it's reconciled as receipts become clear to the forecast. So there is a reconciliation over time over the change to the of any change in relation to the forecast of what was anticipated.
So there'll be a block grant adjustment for 17-18, based on the SFC forecast, but then that block grant adjustment could change depending on what the actual receipts are.
That's correct, yes.
Right. And for 16-17, I think you've agreed 600 million as the block grant adjustment. That would also be revised as we go forward and we find out what the receipts are.
I think there is provision within the agreement which says that there is, this is without prejudice
yeah, I did see that
to the changes for 15-16. The issues around 16-17, I think, will be the subject of some further discussion with the Treasury, given the fact that we agreed that block grant adjustment out with the details of the fiscal framework negotiations.
Okay. And my final area was just on the SFC forecast themselves. I mean, have you had any discussions with them and about timescales for them being up and running? Will they be able to do forecasts for 17-18? Okay.
That's a subject that is under active discussion, because the forecast for 17-18 will essentially have to be available by September, when the normal statutory budget process would take its course. And that strikes me as being, there are two things about that. The first is that I may as well rehearse some of this territory, convener, for the benefit of the committee and the wider audience. The changes in the agreement in relation to fiscal scrutiny that can be enacted by Parliament, if Parliament agrees to do so, in relation to the stage three of the Scottish Fiscal Commission bill, which will come to Parliament on the 10th of March, can only relate to the Scotland Act 2012, because we do not yet have legislative competence to exercise any changes in relation to the Scotland Act or Scotland Bill 2016. So the only changes we can bring forward will be to put in place a rolling 5-year average, for example, a rolling 5-year forecast, for example, on LBTT, landfill tax, income tax, non-domestic rates, over a 5-year.
Sorry, can I just clarify that? So are you saying that although we won't have power over the full range of income tax until that's passed in Westminster? Can we not even forecast these things before we've got the power?
No. Well, I can't mandate the Fiscal Commission to do that statutorily, because we don't have the legislative competence to do so. That will only arise once we've got the Scotland back, once the Scotland Bill gets royal assent. So we can't legislate for things for which we don't yet have legislative consent. Okay. That's not allowed. I'm afraid to say. So we'll make those changes, and we will go through I'm yet to clarify exactly how far the Fiscal Commission will be able to go in its forecasting responsibilities, even in relation to the a forecast for 17-18 on land and buildings transaction tax, for example, given that the Fiscal Commission today, on the 2nd of March, doesn't have that independent forecasting capability. That rests within that forecasting capability rests within government. And there will also be important information about having access to data, which was part of a reciprocal agreement with the United Kingdom government.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, Gavin, to follow by Mark.
Thank you. Okay, once the outturn figures are there, you run the comparable model with the per capita index deduction model. If there is a difference, then an adjustment is made. So if the per capita index deduction is more favourable, then that's helpful to the Scottish Government. In the hypothetical situation where the comparable model would actually have been better for Scotland in any one fiscal year, what happens? Do we move to PCID anyway?
I think Mr. Brown is getting his... he's adding one hypothetical onto another hypothetical. To try to imagine circumstances that will not materialise.
Okay, but if it did, I don't think I'm adding one hypothetical to another. I think there's one hypothetical. If that system, for whatever reason, turned out to be better in one fiscal year, you make the change to PCID anyway. I mean, is that technically correct?
That's the rationale of the agreement. Yes.
Yeah, okay. No. Thank you. In terms of the independent report. Obviously, there's input from both governments in setting it up. It's produced by the end of 2021. What is the status of that report? Is that report legally binding on both governments, or is it politically highly persuasive? Is there a formal status of that report?
It's a report provided to both governments.
So it's not legally binding in any way.
No.
But it's then a matter for governments to agree, yeah, how to treat that report.
The report, the paragraph 22 is very clear. The review will be informed by an independent report with recommendations presented to both governments by the end of 2021.
Okay. You've been asked a couple of questions by the convener and the deputy in relation to behavioural effects, which I guess are captured mainly at paragraphs 50 and 51 of the agreement. You've talked about there being a high bar, you've talked about hypotheticals and so on. My own view, having read it, is that there would be some merit in both governments sitting down before disputes arise, i.e. now, when you're producing various annexes. Could you not give, you know, a number of hypothetical situations that could be covered? In the way that, I suppose, when you did the LBTT bill a couple of years ago, or at least the consultation for that, you outlined, you know, probably half a dozen hypotheticals to work out what sort of treatment would be given. It strikes me that there's merit in governments doing that now when there isn't actually a dispute. Have you had that discussion with the UK government?
I've gone through certain hypothetical circumstances with the UK government on what might be or might not be envisaged in this respect. I don't actually think that type of analysis helps in this respect. You know, the difference with the LBTT proposition is that I wasn't giving hypothetical situations, I was modelling particular scenarios and setting out what would happen in terms of revenue raising if I did certain tax decisions. It's fundamentally different from identifying what one government might do and how that might have an effect on the effects of another. I think what's clear, though, is the language of this section is designed to be to set a very high bar before we'd get into this territory.
Okay. Let's look at one that may actually occur then. I mean, if you're re-elected Deputy First Minister, in terms of your commitments you've made publicly, we get APD in 2018. I think your stated commitment is to reduce that by 50% over the lifetime of a parliament. if that helps airports in Scotland and airports in the north of England lose business, is it clear how that would be, in terms of the agreement you've structured, is it clear how that scenario, should it arise, would be treated?
We would have to go through the we'd have to go through a process of negotiation and discussion around any of the issues around that question.
Okay. Could you be a bit more vague? Forgive me. That sounded a bit churlish, but there are some disputes that we know may arise. I suppose I'm just trying to put the point forward. Is it not worth doing a bit more groundwork now instead of if they arise in a couple of years' time, then working out what does this agreement
mean? We've got an agreement here which essentially sets out the approach that to be taken in relation to spillover effects. It's set out in some considerable detail from section 44 onwards. There are direct effects which we can quite easily tabulate. There are behavioural effects which are less easy to tabulate. We've agreed to take account for all direct effects, I think that's a pretty clear approach that's been set out.
Okay, I won't press that any further. In terms of capital borrowing then, you've been asked some questions on that. Are you able to just give us an indication of the practical effect of the changes? It goes up to 3 billion and I think you're allowed 15% of CDEL instead of 10%. So if this financial year, I think you're allowed to borrow, is it 304 million? In a sort of annualised sum, what are you likely to be able to borrow once this agreement is enforced?
Well, the first point is to correct Mr. Brown. The 15% is off the overall borrowing cap, which is different from the Scotland Act 2012 provisions, which were set at 10% of the Scottish Government's capital budget, total. So if I was to take that number, the capital borrowing limit for the current financial year is £304 million. For 2016-17, it is £316 million. And what the 15% of the overall cap on capital borrowing would be £450 million. So essentially, a number in the low... Obviously, the number on the... on capital borrowing under the Scotland Act would have changed over the duration of the spending review because it's a factor of CDEL and the CDEL line is rising. So I think by about 2019-20, the CDEL borrowing total would have been about £330 million, I think, by the end of the spending review. And the equivalent number will be 450.
So just for clarity, the 450 would be the annual figure at the end of the spending review?
The capital borrowing limit is 15% of the overall borrowing cap. So in 2017-18, the borrowing powers come into effect on the 1st of April 2017, or the new borrowing powers, on the 1st of April 2017. In that financial year, 2017-18, the borrowing limit will be £450 million. Right. Under the Calman proposals or the Scotland Act 2012, I would imagine that number would be something like about 322, something like that.
All right, that's helpful, thank you. In terms of resource borrowing, in terms of the agreement, it says resource borrowing takes place over a period of 3 to 5 years. For any individual item of resource borrowing, do you agree whether it's 3, 4, or 5, or can you simply decide we want to? This one's 3, this one's 4, this one's 5? Is that
It's at the discretion of Scottish ministers. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. And just the last thing, paragraph 76, because I don't think this came up last week. The Scotland Reserve captain aggregate is 700 million. Just for the sake of the record, can you just maybe outline just a, the basics of the Scotland Reserve? Because I said I don't think we did cover it last week.
What the Scotland Reserve does is bring together the cash reserve provision of the Scotland Act 2012, which essentially was a reserve fund held at the Treasury, which into which excess proceeds of our which arose on our tax devolved taxes generated in Scotland, which we had not predicted to be deployed in our public expenditure, would go into. So excess proceeds, if we said we were going to generate, let's say, £500 million in tax and we generated £525 million, if we'd agreed with the Treasury £500 million and we generated £525 million, then £25 million would go into the cash reserve in the UK Treasury, capped at £125 million. And that could only be used to deal with any shortfall in tax revenue in a later year. So if in a later year we were short by £10 million, we could dip into that cash reserve and everything would be neutral. So the Scotland Reserve is a combination of that facility with our budget exchange mechanism. So those two are combined. They have a combined aggregate of £700 million. And we have the ability to undertake annual drawdowns from that reserve of £250 million for resource and £100 million for capital. And that is less restrictive than the terms of the cash reserve in the Scotland Act 2012.
OK, so I guess a big change then is you could draw down reserve or capital for any areas of public spending on which you want to use, as opposed to cover
just
a shortfall.
Just for shortfalls in tax. Yeah. Obviously, on the budget exchange mechanism, there was an annual limit on that of around about £150 million of resource, about £40 million of capital, which we were free to roll forward and to utilise in the careful and prudent management of public finances.
Okay, grateful. Thank you. Convener, thank you.
Okay, thank you. Mark to follow by Jackie.
Thank you very much, Convener. Just wanted to ask a couple of questions, Cabinet Secretary. The first was around the use of year prior to devolution for baseline adjustment in some instances, as opposed to perhaps an average calculated over a number of years. And I just wondered, in terms of that, obviously, if the year prior to devolution is a year of poorer economic performance or output than perhaps previous years averaged out would have been, has the risk factor inherent in that been taken into consideration when agreeing to that model?
Yes, because I think because the pattern of taxation, tends to be fairly stable on most items. Although there can be variations in terms of an economic shock, and we have to be mindful of all of that. But I think in the current context, and looking at the period in which these decisions will be taken, I think that's a reasonable risk, with the exception that some provisions are more volatile. So we've got specific provision in the agreement around cold weather payments, because the performance on those is wildly varied given temperature, and the agreement bluntly it takes in the cold years in averaging it out. So
okay, in terms of the issue around no detriment and dispute resolution, I note the disaggregation of indirect and second round effects, and I just wondered if there was any determination given as to how far after a policy decision had taken effect before you would consider something to be a second round effect as opposed to a delayed behavioural response, if you follow my logic there.
Well, I think the issue of second round effects is covered by section 48. which says that the governments have agreed that the financial consequences of these should not be included in the scope of the no detriment principle. So I think what that would say to me is that it really is very clear direct effects that are essentially the central proposition that's in scope.
So I guess the causality, I know it talks about assessment of causality a number of times during this. Is that an assessment that is to be undertaken by the, for example, the Fiscal Commission and OBR, or by others, or will it be the governments themselves who look at how causality is to be determined?
Essentially, the governments will look at this information, but there may be occasions in which we seek kind of wider counsel on these questions, but fundamentally it's about the governments that will undertake that.
And then that brings me on to the section on dispute resolution, sort of 98 to 104, which I think you've alluded to there. I note that essentially it says if no agreement can be reached, then the dispute falls. There would be no specific outcome for the dispute, and so no fiscal transfer between the governments. And I guess the concern I would have from a Scottish perspective there is if there were to be intransigence in relation to a decision that the Treasury had taken that affected the Scottish budget, and the Treasury simply dug their heels in, is there the potential then that no fiscal transfer might take place as a consequence of that?
Well, I suppose in the interest of fair play, for which I am renowned, I would have to accept there might be perceived intransigence at the other end of the East Coast main rail line. So I'm not talking about Aberdeen in that respect. So I think what the dispute resolution procedure is designed to do is to essentially encourage an evidence-based approach to the formulation of a resolution of these issues. So it walks through step by step how evidence can be gathered, and at paragraph 101, the technical input on the dispute may be sought from the OBR and the Scottish Fiscal Commission, which brings in some other independent empirical analysis in the process. So I think the provisions are there to, I think, provide a fair process of resolving any of these questions that may arise based on the evidence that is available in these circumstances.
I note as well that the findings of technical input and analysis would also be published, and I know that through the Devolution and Further Powers Committee, on which I also sit, we've discussed how to improve those intergovernmental relations and negotiations and discussions that take place. So would you see this as being a much more public mechanism for resolving disputes than perhaps would have otherwise been the case under previous joint exchequer committees?
I think it's more transparent. So there's more evidence presented about what this is about. There's work undertaken by both governments. It's a joint process. It is encouraged to be resolved in a timeous fashion. It can be informed by external opinion. So I think there's a lot to be confident about that process being able to be operated in a spirit of good faith.
And I know it's not mentioned in the heads of agreement, but would you envisage a role for either this committee or a successor committee, or if there is a successor committee to the Devolution Further Powers Committee, in terms of probing into the dispute that exists and what the positions of the governments are?
I suppose that, well obviously it's entirely a matter for committees and for Parliament to decide what they decide to look at. I think there's obviously there's an intergovernmental process set out here to try to resolve these issues. If Parliament or committees felt that they wished to exercise some scrutiny of that from their own perspectives, then I could see no reasonable basis of resisting that.
Okay, thank you. Okay.
Thank you. Jackie, to follow by Jean.
Thank you. Can I start with the question of transparency that was raised by Mark MacDonald? Obviously, we haven't yet seen the detailed annexes to the agreement. I suspect a lot of the detail that we crave may well lie in there. and both, I think yourself, at both the Finance Committee, or certainly in a letter to us, and at the Devolution Committee, indicated you would be looking to publish those. Have we any sense of when they're likely to be published?
I can't give a definitive timescale on that. I'm not sure that the detail or the answers that Jackie Bailey is looking for will be in that detailed work, because I expect that to be very technical information about how this is constructed. This is the agreement. There's not another document that will give us more of the agreement. This is the agreement. There will be technical information that will underpin the agreement, but this is the agreement.
I understand that. I think in your evidence to both committees, you talked about the key documents on the fiscal framework that would support the scrutiny process. So, you know at least some of the committee's attention to detail. We had been led to believe that there were underpinning documents that you would publish, and I think that would certainly be very useful that commitment.
There will be the technical documents that support this agreement will be public documents, but I'm simply saying that I'm just giving the committee a flavour of where I think the substance of the issues that have been agreed between the governments are essentially represented by the document the committee has in front of it just now, and the technical information is simply to support what is here in the agreement.
Well, we look forward to receiving that. Can I take you to paragraph 12 on forestalling? And just note, as I think I did with you separately, that the forestalling adjustment figure for LBTT appears to be 20 million. The committee got quite excited previously that the OBR suddenly agreed that forestalling was 30 million and perhaps expected more money to come to the government as a consequence of that. I wonder whether you would address that point, but also in a related point, if no additional forestalling will be available for new powers, I am concerned about the mechanisms that we use to set budgets and the timeline that is involved in that for new tax powers, for example. And I wonder whether this isn't something, convener, we maybe capture for a legacy paper for the Finance Committee, but I would welcome your comments in the meantime.
On the first point that Jackie Bailey has raised, the 20 million figure represents the gain that is assessed by the OBR to have been made by the UK government in S-deal and stamp duty land tax that they have gained at the essentially on a, because of the time difference and the changes being announced. So that's a figure beyond dispute and calculated by the OBR, and I've accepted that. Now, Jackie Bailey raises what I think is a fair point in relation to the second part of section 12 of the agreement, which is something about which Parliament has to be mindful and government has to be mindful in taking decisions about tax issues, because essentially the agreement closes off any further forestalling effects being taken into account in intergovernmental relations. Now again, we come back to, this is one of the issues that we've agreed on. It creates an issue that Parliament has to be mindful of if we're taking any decisions in the future. I do think, however, it opens up some questions for Parliament and the committee about how our financial procedures and our tax decisions are actually taken, and I would welcome the consideration of the committee on the issues around essentially this is about the interaction with the budget process in the Scottish Parliament. In 1999, I was one of the members of this distinguished committee which passed did the preparatory work on the Public Finance and Accountability Scotland Bill, our tax powers were essentially were restricted to Scottish variable rate, and they really didn't countenance any of these provisions around borrowing, about different forms of taxation, all sorts of issues. So those very good and robust arrangements put in place for the budget process, which has given the Parliament a very commendable exemplary process of budget scrutiny might not be appropriate for the issues that we now wrestle with in terms of tax decisions. Now, that's not necessarily an issue just, but obviously I've got some opinions about that from my experience, but it's something that I think the committee, it would be helpful if the committee considered these points in its legacy approach.
Okay, thank you. Sticking with the impact on the budget timetable, because obviously the lead-in time for the Scottish Fiscal Commission to assume its new powers and have them, you know, effectively operational is an issue that will, I think, bump up against the immediacy of the budget process. Now, if SFC and OBR are both doing forecasting, we've already acknowledged the data limitations. They forecast, I think, at different times. OBR is biannual, whether we would have that kind of married together. I just wonder, in terms of the timetable for next year's budget, what you think are the potential consequences. Do you think SFC will be ready by September, or are you looking to implement later?
I think it's unlikely the Fiscal Commission will be ready for September. I think, in all fairness to the members of the Fiscal Commission, it would be a lot to ask of them, given what I've also said about the fact that the what we would be asking, what we could only ask them to do, would be around LBTT, landfill tax, income tax, and non-domestic rates. But even on non-domestic rates, the Fiscal Commission will not have, we won't have given them legislative authority to give them access to information held by the assessors, which the government has, but they don't have. So I think for 17-18, we will be looking at, our process will have to be appropriate for the powers and the capability that exist for that circumstance. I'm keen to get the Fiscal Commission into a position that can exercise its full responsibilities as quickly as possible. But I think it'd be only fair for me to say to the committee today, I don't think that will be the case for 2017-18.
So you don't see them exercising their powers in advance of 17-18. Does that therefore mean that some of the choices we have about exercising those new powers are put off until such time as the Fiscal Commission is able to forecast?
I'm not following the point that...
Okay, if we're saying a lot of the data on which you would base your budget is going to be down to the Fiscal Commission forecasting, if they're not up and running, it's just simply an administrative point, if they're not up and running and able to advise on those things, does that mean that as a consequence of that, decisions, say you chose to, as it is rumoured, raise the top band of income tax to 50 pence? And we look forward to seeing that announcement in due course. But if that's the case, does that have any practical implication on your ability to do that in 17-18 if the Fiscal Commission has not done anything in advance?
No, not at all. But what it means is that it won't have the Fiscal Commission's imprimatur on it as a forecast from them. Okay. But, for example, my LBTT forecast for 2017-18 will go through the same amount of scrutiny that the Fiscal Commission would apply to them, but has applied to them over the last couple of years.
Okay, but not in terms of new powers. It's just to clarify that, because ideally then we would want the Fiscal Commission in place as quickly as possible.
Yes, but I think in all fairness, I think it would be a lot to ask members of the Commission to take on that responsibility to be ready for September.
Okay, I understand that. Can I move on to the block grant adjustment? This is my final area of questioning. The mechanism is obviously in place for 5 years, subject to review. Now, it's clear that the outcome you want is index capital deduction. That's going to be achieved as a consequence of this, and that's very helpful. Can I ask then, why are we using the comparable model as well? Is it a sign, forgive me for asking this, that the Treasury hasn't quite given up on it? And what we're doing is delaying that debate for 5 years?
I think if Jackie Bailey wanted to probe Treasury intentions, I would gracefully say to her that I'm not the man to ask about that.
But you have an opinion on most things, Cabinet Secretary, so I wondered whether I might
invite
you to share.
Where would we... I think we've come to an agreement whereby I have got the outcome I wanted on block grant adjustment. The route by which we've got it is somewhat circuitous, but we've got the outcome I wanted.
I absolutely understand that. Will you publish both numbers? because I think it would be very interesting for us to see the relative advantage that your model may well have over the comparable model that the Treasury are supporting.
I could see no good reason why that wouldn't be the case.
Excellent, that's good. It strikes me, and I don't know, but I'm making assumptions, that the real consequences for our budget arise when there is a more divergent kind of level of population between the rest of the UK and ourselves, and actually the effects of that are much further down the road. Again, I come back to, is this not just a case of putting it off until the numbers become more acute later on?
No. We already carry population risk within the Barnett formula, and that's an established part of our financial arrangements. And secondly, the agreement we've arrived at is that the outcome of per capita index deduction will be delivered, and in the short term and the medium term, and these issues will be considered in the review in 2021-22, at which point the Scottish Government has as much negotiating leeway and influence over the process as we've had in this particular process.
Okay. I know I've explored this before, but let me do so again. If there is disagreement, and I know that you are such a consensual politician, that is unthinkable for you, but let's just assume there is disagreement at the end of the review, and despite all the reassurances you're given, what would be our fallback position? Is it the status quo, as is set out in the dispute resolution mechanism? If that's so, is the status quo what existed prior to the agreement or post-agreement? I want to know what we're left with.
Well, there can only be one status quo, which is the one that's there at the time.
So is that...
That wasn't a kind of rock band comment. There's only one status quo, but there can only be one status quo. It's the one that's there at the time.
So that's post-agreement.
Well, this agreement, that's what will be there in 2022.
Okay, that's fine. As long as that's your understanding, I will undoubtedly explore this with Treasury as well, so we have a shared understanding on what happens in the event of disagreement.
I think the key point about the shared understanding of what happens in 2022 is there has to be an agreement between the two governments. That's the shared understanding.
Okay, but actually, whilst that is the desirable outcome, there will be circumstances in which that shared agreement might not be reached, and I seek to understand the totality of what is on the table before people.
There's a requirement to come to an agreement. That's the requirement, and we've gone through that process and got to this point of agreement already.
Okay. Can I ask, in terms of the review, details of that review and details of the overall review of the fiscal framework, will these be published in due course? Because I don't think there's a great deal of information about who's in the review, etc.
The review at sections 20 to 23 will be the subject of discussion and agreement between the two governments, and of course that will have to be set out to Parliament to enable the Parliament to consider these issues. And then at sections 111 to 113, there is a further detail given about the review to ensure that all of these matters are and other issues in relation to the Smith Commission recommendations are considered appropriately.
Okay, the Finance Committee certainly had a recommendation for some kind of independent arbiter. I understand that there is a review of the protocol on the resolution and avoidance of disputes. Is that something that you're likely to recommend as part of that process?
What would I be likely to recommend?
The Finance Committee's recommendation
of an independent arbiter.
To you, which is an independent arbiter that might be useful in a dispute resolution process.
I would be quite happy with the concept of independent arbitration and argued for it within the discussions with the UK government, but I was unable to secure agreement at that point.
Okay, thank you very much, Convener.
Jean?
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, could I just ask about the administration implementation costs on page 5? At paragraph 31, we're talking about the 200 million that was, I think, estimated to be between 400 and 600, and an agreement with 200. But the last sentence, the profile of this transfer is to be agreed by the joint Exchequer Committee. What does that mean?
Is it a one-off payment? You know, for example, is it a one-off payment of 200 million in 2016, or is it 450 million payments over a four-year period? That's the only issue.
So. Okay, and the Joint Exchequer Committee are referred to quite often still as, you know, it's still to be agreed by. What does the Joint Exchequer Committee look like, and how open will their discussions be in these negotiations?
The Joint Exchequer Committee is essentially the Chief Secretary of the Treasury and me. That is the Joint Exchequer Committee, and supported by our respective officials. And the Joint Exchequer Committee is obliged to work in a fashion that secures agreement. The terms of reference of the Joint Exchequer Committee are actually included in Annex. No, they're not. They'll be in the, sorry, the terms of reference of the Joint Exchequer Committee will be in the technical annex that I was referring to Jackie Bailey about a second ago. And essentially, the working approach of the Joint Exchequer Committee is to try to reach agreement on particular issues that are referred to them, or which they have a responsibility to try to address.
Okay. And the Barnett formula is still, I think, a mystery to most people. There's a reference to it throughout some of the evidence that we've been taking about understanding the Barnett formula. Do you understand the Barnett formula?
I would like to believe so, but whether I entered the mastermind with my special subject being the Barnett formula would be a different question. But I would like to think I understand it. Yes. Would the committee like an explanation? The Barnett formula essentially looks at the decisions are taken by the UK government about public expenditure in England. The Barnett formula is then applied to the changes that are made, and the Scottish budget is varied to take account of those changes. Now, the kind of core calculation is driven by a set of what are called comparability factors that are published in the Statement of Funding Policy. At one extreme, health has a comparability factor of 100. So if the health budget increases by £100 million, Scotland will get a population share of that £100 million increase. If the defence budget increases by £100 million, the comparability factor is zero. So we will get no financial benefit from the increase in the defence budget directly to the Scottish block of expenditure. And those numbers are present at any fiscal event. The changes in departmental budgets in England are tabulated by the Office for Budget Responsibility. We can see those visibly. The comparability factors are applied to that. It all appears in a spreadsheet that's available to me, my officials, and I scrutinise that. To our satisfaction, the Barnett formula has been properly applied, and Barnett fundamentally is a population share model, which is applied to changes in public expenditure in England.
Okay, thank you. On page 13, there's reference to the Crown Estate powers being devolved, and I should get this, but I'm a bit confused. The government's block grant will be equal to the net revenues generated by Crown Estate assets in Scotland, I understand, and transferred. What I not quite sure of is the net costs. Does that mean that the net costs of running the Crown Estate in Scotland are still met by the UK government?
No, because the Crown Estate is devolved. So we have, so the net revenues are what are used to paid out of Scottish revenue.
But they're also deducted from the amount being transferred.
Essentially what is happening is that the revenues of the Crown Estate and the Crown Estate are being devolved to Scotland, and out of those revenues we have to run the Crown Estate.
Right. So why would there be any transfer of income then? If the Crown Estate in Scotland is now an independent entity, why would it affect the Barnett formula or any other calculation or any other Westminster tax? Would it not be operating like an independent department in Scotland?
I'm not following the issue that Jean Urquhart is troubled by. Essentially, the Crown Estate is devolved, and then the revenues that come, that would be generated in Scotland from that activity, become available to, let me call it, the Scottish Crown Estate, to fund its activities.
Yes. But we're still talking here about them affecting the block grant. Governments have agreed that a baseline deduction to the Scottish Government's block grant will be equal to the net revenues generated by the Crown Estates. So does it mean that the Crown Estate in Scotland, all the revenues will still go to Westminster and be transferred back?
No, we'll keep them.
No.
So we'll
there's
keep
no
them.
Effect on this, on the block grant?
Well, there is an effect on the block grant because we have to there has to be, essentially, the Crown Estate revenue currently flows into the Treasury across the United Kingdom. The Crown Estate revenue flows into the Treasury and it goes into, let me call it, the big pot. And we get our block grant out of the big pot. If we're not entitled to get, if we're getting to retain the revenues from Scotland for the Crown Estate, our block grant therefore has to be reduced to make that essentially a neutral transaction.
Net of the costs of running it?
No. The cost of running it will be within the revenues that are generated in Scotland.
Right.
So what will happen is that on a neutral basis, the block grant will be reduced to take account of the the fact that Scotland is going to retain the revenues that are generated from Crown Estate activities within Scotland, apart from the Fort Kinnear Shopping Centre, I might add. So that will flow into the Scottish Government, and our block grant will come down. It will be replaced by revenues in the Crown Estate, and we have to pay for the running of the Crown Estate in Scotland from those revenues.
Okay.
So essentially, it's the application of the no detriment principle.
Yeah, and that gives us full control of the Crown Estate too, I presume. I mean,
we then stray out of the fiscal framework into the Scotland bill, where, you know, my criticism and the government's criticism of the mechanism that's been selected for the devolution of the Crown Estate is, I don't think it's quite as simple as Jean Urquhart has just expressed there, that we have full control. It's a scheme of devolution. It is terribly cumbersome. It's terribly restrictive. And I think that, I think it could have been done in a much simpler fashion. And we suggested alternatives to the United Kingdom government as to how that could be done, but they were intent on taking forward. So it's probably one of the remaining handful of issues with which we still have a disagreement about the contents of the Scotland Bill with the United Kingdom Government, because we consider those provisions to be unnecessarily restrictive.
And should the Scottish Government introduce a new tax, say a land tax, for example, which could do, would that affect the block grant? Is there any challenge to Scotland about growing taxes?
If we wanted to introduce a new tax, we would have to secure the prior consent of the United Kingdom Government to so do. So that's a provision which has existed since the Scotland Act 2012, whereby we have got the ability to generate a new tax if we wish to do so, but we have to seek the prior consent of the United Kingdom Government, given the fact that they have reserved responsibility for taxation, unless devolved to us through provisions such as the Scotland Act 2012 or the Scotland Act 2016.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you very much. That's concluded questions for the committee. Just one issue of clarification. APD was raised a couple of times. I understood that in terms of the no detriment principle, the Chancellor had said on the 19th of January last year that he didn't consider devolution of APD to be a breach of no detriment at all.
I think that the Chancellor made a very helpful contribution to the Treasury Select Committee in that discussion, where I think he put into proper context some issues such as the change in APD, and essentially being an illustration of the fact that if governments wish to do something differently and to take different steps, they should be free to do so.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Any further points you would wish to raise in the committee? Okay, just before I wind up this session, I want to thank Professor Gavin McEwen for all the tremendous and invaluable advice that he's actually given the committee. This is going to be the last committee at which he attends. I have to say a lot of the work that we've done has been highly complex, and if it wasn't for Professor McEwen, I think it would have been a much more difficult task for the Finance Committee. So I want to put on record our thanks for all the work he's actually done for the Finance Committee. So thank you. That being the end of our public deliberations, we'll now call I now close the public part of this meeting.